podcast. We just had this young gentleman on, but we had to get him back on here ASAP. PokerStars has lost their fucking mind, guys. PokerStars made some VIP changes. They made some changes that not many people are happy about, and me and my friend Dani Stern, aka Ansky, are here to discuss it. Dani's been pretty active on the social media platform and on 2+2 about his opinion on the changes, and we're going to talk about it. Dani, how's it going? What's up? Thanks for joining me here, Poppy.
How's it going? Thanks for having me. And I'm pretty shocked by it all. I mean, everybody knew something was coming, but this is something else, I think.
Yeah, so there's a link in the description if you guys are watching this back on YouTube right now. If you're watching on Twitch, you got to go be a detective and find the link. But basically, here's what's going down, guys. I want to read the official changes. So here's what happened. First of all, PokerStars Russia allegedly posted out some link to changes for the VIP program in 2016, 2017, and beyond. Now, obviously, as Dani said, we knew changes were coming. We knew something was going to happen. Might not have expected the changes that happened. So, Dani, do you want to just tell people what are the basic main, the biggest changes that's going to be happening?
Yeah, so the initial posting we were referring to happened was on the Russian PokerStars VIP site. They said that was where it leaked to, basically, and people read Google Translates of it. And the gist of it was they're reducing Supernova Elite from 70% rake back to 30, but they've since changed that, and now it's back to 45. They're completely removing all VPPs, all rake back from 510 and higher cash games. I think it's like 2040 and higher limit cash games. I believe they're taking away the Supernova free roll, the quarterly free roll, and they are devaluing FPPs by 25%. They are phasing out Supernova Elite by 2017. And there's no longer going to be Supernova Elite. The language of the post by Stars is basically completely insulting as a intelligent consumer of their product. They present it as this is good for the games. We're going to restore the health to the games that has been lacking in recent years, because basically the current system just rewards the mass multi-tablers and the super high volume, and poker is no longer about the gamesmanship of competing with one fellow gambler and just defeating them at the table. Now it's all about using stats and creating making money off your rake back. Now, just the beginning of the absurdity of this is PokerStars rakes games high enough, so high in certain stakes in certain games that it is impossible to win unless you play ultra high volume. And then they say, well, these ultra high volume players are killing the games. Well, meanwhile, they design this entire system like that. Okay. Now, I want to be clear. It's fine for them to change the VIP system. It's totally fine for them, in my opinion, to say Supernova Elite is not working anymore. We can't keep encouraging this system. It worked during the boom when we had tons of depositors and all we wanted was just as much action as possible. But now that there's less depositors, we have to slow their process of how they lose the money and give them a better playing experience in order to sustain the longevity of the games, which is, I think, a fine position to have. And that is what they're pretending that their position is. It's total nonsense, though. Okay. First of all, they've been lying and deceiving their Supernova Elite users all year. These are literally their best customers. These are people who do nothing but play poker on PokerStars. Okay. Not only that, they're promoted by Stars. You look on their VIP site on the explanation of their VIP system, they love pumping up the Supernova Elite players. Like, this guy has made 5 million VPPs. This guy has made 10 million VPPs. If you make this many VPPs, this is what will happen to you, okay? So now they're literally taking that, and in some cases for cash game players, they're basically going from promoting that for the 70% rake back and giving them zero now, despite them being their best customers, okay? And instead of doing it, making it a reasonable transition where, look, they could say, you know, you were our best customers, but we've decided our business is better, or the market for poker is better if we shift it towards more recreational rewards by doing this, okay? But we will honor our agreement that we have with you until 2017. But they didn't do that. They're cutting the rewards for Supernova League for 2016. And what people need to understand is that the VIP system is a two-year program, because it, when you achieve one of the rewards of achieving Supernova Elite for a given year is that you maintain the status for the next year. And this is advertised and written on their site. It's still written on their site right now, okay? And it's not true anymore. They're saying they're not going to honor it. They know that players on Stars who make a decision to go for Supernova Elite at the beginning of 2015, they're doing so under the assumption that they will be able to maintain Supernova Elite status into 2016, which is part of the value of being Supernova Elite. Okay? But now they're retroactively saying 10 months into the year that they're no longer going to honor that it's no longer a two-year program. They're going to slash the rewards dramatically, in some cases by 25%, in some cases by the full 70. And that's it. And there's nothing you can do about it. And the even more absurd part about this is they said that, first of all, they said, well, we warned you, basically. They did not warn anything. They said there would be comprehensive change, or there would be changes. They didn't say if they would be positive or negative. They didn't say anything about that, okay? Even if they knew, or either they didn't know at that point what they were going to change, in which case it's unreasonable for them to have expected us to know. How are we supposed to know if they didn't know? That's a completely absurd position for them to have. Or they knew exactly what they were going to do. They knew at least that they were going to cut Supernova Elite, and then they chose not to tell anyone at the beginning of the year just so they could rake more money for the whole year. People are playing, like, PokerStars knows very well that they have people that are raking $200,000, $300,000, $500,000 a year for them in games which they don't win at. They know that they don't win at these games, but they play them because they get rake back that is promised to them by Stars, and it's part of the, I mean, Stars hasn't said, we invite you to play this game where you don't have an edge, but we'll give you rake back. But that's the environment that they've created, and they have said this is what the rewards you'll get. You know, they said this is the rewards you'll get, and they get people to play in certain conditions that they might not otherwise play because they know that they're getting rake back, and then 10 months into the year, they pull out the rake back. They're saying, no, we're not going to give it to you. And on top of all of this, this was leaked. Who knows when they would have released the information?
Right. So let me clarify a couple of things Donnie just said for you.
On the Russian site, it got leaked and now they released it. Who knows? I wonder when they would have released it. Maybe they would have released it on January 1st.
All right, let me clarify a couple of things Donnie said. So he mentioned that the Supernova Elite, the percentage rake back is going to be 75 to 30. So what's actually going to be is 45% for 2016, and then they're on Supernova Elite's getting rid of it. It's 30%. They did give back a little bit, guys. I got to tell you about this great thing Stars did. So they're giving back 10% to the Chrome Stars, which if any of you guys are out there, if you're a Chrome Star, you know you have Chrome Star status for maybe 50 hands of poker, and it's going to make you an extra 30 cents a year. So I just want to congratulate all the Chrome Stars out there. That's the increase they've given back. So they are giving back to the players. Let's not act like they're not giving back to the players.
I want to clarify what you just said, because you said it in a joking manner, because it sounds so absurd that it has to be a joke. But I want people to understand that that's not a joke, what he said. Mm-hmm. In their table of how they're altering the VIP system, where they're supposedly doing it to benefit the recreational players and give back more money to recreational players, the Chrome Star is the only status that gets it, that has an increase in more FPPs, or that their rake back is going to go up. Bronze Star is the same. Platinum Star goes down by 10%. Supernova goes down, or I'm not sure exactly what Supernova was. Elite is going down by 25%. Chrome Stern is the only one that goes up, and it's going up by 10%. Okay? That is a literal increase of 30 to 50 cents per month. Cents, as in 30 cents, as in one-third of a dollar per month. Way to redistribute the wealth, PokerStars.
And what Dani was talking about initially was somebody said that these changes were coming. And that was actually, so PokerStars has also decided to make a reappearance in the 2+2 forums after a very long, I don't know where they went. They disappeared for a long time, but they're back now with they made a thread, 2016 PokerStars VIP Club. They posted a couple times and they let people know in that thread that they told you these changes were coming. Now, as Dani said, they didn't necessarily tell you what changes were, I didn't tell you any, what were they, good or bad? Maybe they're increasing the rake back. I mean, obviously they're not going to fucking increase the rake back, but maybe, you never know. But they let people know in 2+2 that they told you these changes were coming. So I thought that was a interesting post they made on the forums. They've only made 4 or 5 posts in the forums, but they've been a little ridiculous in nature as well. And obviously Daniel Negreanu, I think you might have been following this on Twitter as well. Daniel Negreanu said that they're also allegedly going to be eliminating HUDs and seeding scripts in the very near future. So I'm not sure if that's not a confirm, but that's pretty much what he made it out to be, like on Twitter in a discussion I believe that you and him were having, correct?
Yeah, I've talked to Daniel a bit since it started. I don't know exactly what's going on with that. The implication seems to be strongly that they're going to eliminate HUDs and seeding scripts, which is fine. I think it's probably going to be good, maybe not, but it's a reasonable change. I don't think you'll see a riot from that. But releasing those two pieces of information at the same time to confuse people and imply that somehow the two are related, they're completely unrelated. You can do one and not do the other very easily. I don't know if the implication is that they're going to take the $50 million that they pay out to Supernova Elite players and use that to ban HUDs. I don't really understand what the implication is. If it's part of an overall plan to change the landscape and to change the games to reduce the value of mass multi-tabling and using statistics to your advantage, fine. You can reduce the use of HUDs, okay? And you can also reduce rewards for high volume players and shift it in another way, you know. But they haven't done that. They've just lied about what they're doing. And they've reneged on their commitments to their literal top customers. So that's where we are now. I think it's like shameful by them. You know, I've always been like a huge PokerStars fan. It's always been my number one site. I've been playing on Stars since 2004, 12 years. And I didn't say anything when they increased the rake last year. I didn't say anything when they added a cash out or a conversion fee. And both of those things, by the way, they did without actually emailing their customers. They just snuck it in without telling anyone and only posted on 2+2 about it so that recreational players wouldn't know. I don't know why they did that, but it clearly shows a history that the company has changed, and this is what I'm getting at. I used to be a huge fan of PokerStars because they showed a remarkable ability as a huge company to connect with their customers and connect with their players, and I think that's why they became the industry leader and why they rose to the top so fast. They provided an excellent atmosphere for players to feel comfortable playing in, and they really assured us on security, you know. Now, like, that's all changed. So they increased they added a cash out or a currency conversion fee without telling anyone. They out of nowhere increased the rake last year, and I still didn't say anything because fundamentally, while I felt those were maybe dishonest and sneaky moves, you know, fundamentally those are basically just price changes. And PokerStars has a right to change their prices. And it's unfortunate that we're in a rigged market where they're the monopoly and there's nothing that any competition can do about it. But this announcement really crossed the line for me, and it made me realize I have to just, I can't like just sit by and watch them do this and tell people that something is happening that isn't happening. You know, it's they're lying to people about what is going on. They're lying. They're making their previous statements lies by not honoring their Supernova Elite agreements. And you know, they've sent a clear message that high stakes poker is no longer a part of our vision for online poker's future. You know,
just to sort of clarify again, so they are getting rid of rakeback completely at 5/10 and above for the big bet games for Nolimit and PLO, and then mixed games, I believe it might be it's 10/20 and above. Mm-hmm. So what that means is for someone like Dani, is that you're gonna be Super Elite this year, right?
No, not this year. I was last year, but I didn't get it this year.
Okay, but what this means for anyone that, I mean, even if you're Supernova, you're now making $0 from rakeback. Any of the Supernova Elites who are regulars are going to make $0 next year if they only play 5/10 and above. And it seems to me like they're trying to phase out the high stakes games without just eliminating the games. This is their way to sort of get all the action down to 2/5 zoom to 3/6, where the rake per hand is bigger than it is at the higher stakes. And I mean, obviously you've seen this with other sites. They've eliminated the high stakes games completely.
Yeah. It's a shocking move by them that makes no sense to me, even from a financial standpoint for them, because this is what's going to happen. This is the effect that they're going to bring. So they're going to disincentivize players to play higher stakes. So what's going to happen is players are going to play who normally played higher are going to play lower. So you're going to have guys who used to play 5/10 or guys who used to play 10/20 are going to play 5/10. Guys who used to play 5/10 are going to play 2/5 now. That's especially going to be the big shift. Okay, the big shift is going to be 5/10 players now playing more 2/5. So what you're doing in effect is you're making the lower stakes games have more pros in them. The better pros are gonna move down. I mean, the pros that played higher stakes are gonna move down to lower stakes. So guys are gonna come from 5/10 to 2/5. Now all of a sudden 2/5 is gonna be tougher, and guys that used to just barely beat 2/5 are gonna move down to 1/2. 1/2 players will move. So it's gonna make the games tougher. This is going to make the games not only tougher in terms of amount of rake back you get back, but it will make the actual games tougher as a result. And if this is some sort of plan to let the net depositors, the recreational players, achieve a better and more enjoyable gaming experience, then I fail to see how this will achieve that. And not to mention, there's this ridiculous notion that like at high stakes, there are no amateurs or something. There are lots of amateurs. That's why games run. Okay, and if this is a move to get them to keep playing longer or whatever, then you're taking money directly out of their pocket. I said this on Twitter several times. I know of many, I don't know the exact number, but I know of quite a few amateurs, some of them I know personally, who are Supernova and not Platinum Star or Chrome Star or whatever. Okay, it's not that much poker in a whole year to get Supernova. There's a lot of amateurs who, you know, play 2 days a week who can get Supernova pretty easily on the year. Okay. And that's like $50,000 out of their pocket next year if they're playing high stakes cash games. Or even mid stakes, whatever you want to call 5/10, 5/10 and up. If they're playing 5/10, that's 50 buy-ins out of their pocket mm-hmm. next year if they would have gotten Supernova. That's 50 buy-ins less for them to lose and keep the games going and keep money getting raked by stars. Okay. I even know of two, I think, amateur players who are Supernova Elite. They don't play cash games though. It's a total misconception that is like only attacking, that this is only going after the pros. It's nonsense. It's going after everyone. And then the one VIP level where you would expect should be the most amateur oriented, or like should have the most impact on amateurs, would be Platinum Star, because it's one right beneath Supernova. And basically hardly any pros are less than Supernova, except maybe like some American pros who just show up to play like Scoop and W Coop or something. But the vast majority of pros are Supernova or Supernova Elite. And so the one right below it, you'd think would be the most valued amateurs, because they're the ones who put in or would it be the most valued VIP status? Because it's going to be amateurs who put in a decent amount of volume, and probably not very many pros, and they're decreasing the rewards by 10%. So I mean, it's almost like they took like a plot of like things to do where they had like different options of what to do, and then they took like 40 darts and they just threw them at the board, and then that's what they picked.
And I think also another big reason a lot of people are upset is because the communication of these things has been, I mean, it's an accidental communication. They didn't necessarily mean to put the information out there right now. And I mean, I guess if we go back, so I'm going to go back. I want to read the Amaya CEO second post he made on 2+2 on June 23rd, 2014. He says, PokerStars has been an industry leader in providing the best game experience, yada, yada, yada. Amaya plans to continue providing an unmatched poker experience that loyal players have grown to expect. The company always operates with the utmost integrity and respect for its customers' base, and PokerStars will continue that approach, led by its experienced executive management team and dedicated employees. Let me be clear in saying that our most important relationship will be with you, the players, and we look forward to building on the trust PokerStars has established with the poker community over the past 14 years. Obviously, that's just like PR bullshit, like whoever, someone wrote that up in a lab. But this, I mean, it is pretty interesting that here we are 1 year and 5 months later, and I mean, this is a complete fucking joke, basically, the post right here.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, he's a CEO of a company. He's going to write a bunch of PR bullshit. My feelings aren't hurt, but it's still just hilarious to read.
Right. And I think, I know Melly B, Mike Brooks, longtime forwarding player, has made some good posts over in the Internet Poker Forum, and he's made a couple. I mean, it's just like the post being made right now by the PokerStars representatives. I mean, I know they're in a tough spot, and who knows if they're the ones making the post or there's a team making the post, but I think it's pretty comical that they're choosing to interact now in the way they're choosing to interact after they've been so quiet for so long. And I think that's what's got people really mad and really angry, is that the way that they're communicating these new changes by accident. There's no official representation. I believe in the 2+2 NVG thread, there is some official representation here in Internet Poker thread, but like there's so much going on. You got Dan Negrano on Twitter, doesn't even know what the changes were, and he knows now, but when they first started being discussed, he's like, oh, seat scripts and HUDs are being banned. Yeah. We didn't know seat scripts and HUDs were being banned until he started making those posts initially. So a lot of people are upset with him. A lot of people are angry with him. There's a lot of people angry with him. He's getting a lot of bad feedback right now on social media. And I mean, you know,
Negrano, the thing is, people need to realize, like, people want him to be like the people's champ and to like speak for us, right?
Agree. Yeah.
He's a paid employee of Stars, and if he's going to do anything, it's going to take time because he has to communicate internally with them. He's not going to, if he's representing this in any way, he's going to do it by speaking with his employers and speaking with people that he knows inside the company. Okay. He's not going to go on Twitter and publicly bash Stars. Like, it's just not realistic, you know? So regardless of whether you're, you know, think that his integrity is compromised based on the money or not, there are some people who are paid employees of Stars, and you need to let them, the way they're going to handle this is going to be differently than like us, the normal players. Right. So people need to just chill and just wait. I'm not saying that you shouldn't give people shit who are deserving of it, but just, that, you know, you need to just wait a little bit. The only that was actually the reason I like kind of exploded on this is because he tweeted that oh, this is great, banning scripts and HUDs, and I was just like, you have no idea what you're talking about. Like, this has nothing to do with what you're talking about, and that just set me off, and I had to write up that post.
Yeah, I got you a little fired up. I can tell you're fired up, man. I like your passion. We don't hear you
fired up. Yeah, I mean, we've only scratched the surface. There's so much.
So let's think about now, and from the perspective of, I mean, we have the high stakes players. I think a lot of our friends are fellow high stakes players, but there's a lot of guys out there who aren't high stakes players. There's a lot of guys who are small stakes, micro stakes players. They mass table. This is really who this affects the most. So in their situation, what do you think of guys like this that are out there that are like, now, you know, they've been so used to living off rakeback. They've been having a 1BB per 100 win rate or break even or slightly losing player, but they've been surviving the past couple of years using their HUDs, using software off the rakeback. Now that's cut in half or cut down by 25%. They can't play as many tables. Their hourly goes down. There's a lot of people in this situation. Now a lot of people out there who aren't pros are going to say, fuck these guys, whatever, get rid of these guys. They're boring players, yada, yada, yada. That's the thing I've been reading. But at the same time, I mean, I think we still care about those players as well. We should care about those players. What do you think those guys should do now?
Well, yeah. I mean, first of all, I think it's really it's absurd and it's just utterly ignorant for people to basically be like, oh, you guys suck. You just use your HUD and you're boring and you're not a real poker player. Like, that's not really poker. Like, it's just such fucking nonsense when people say that. It's always from people who have absolutely no clue what they're talking about. They have no knowledge of the subject whatsoever. Okay, first of all, you know, I've done a lot of like coaching over the years and things like that. I've coached players who play 50 cent a dollar. And let me tell you, like, these guys who are winning at it, they're really smart and they're really hardworking, good poker players, a lot of them. These games are not that easy, okay? And a lot of them, you know, if you had transported them back 5 years ago and they were playing 50, 100, no limit, they would smash, okay? They would just crush it, okay? The game has gotten much tougher over the years, and for people to achieve any kind of success at you know, 100 no limit or 200 no limit, they should be proud of that. It's not, you know, they're not just some, it's a ridiculous statement to say they're just like bots and they just go off the numbers. Anyone who says that those people are just playing off their HUDs couldn't tell you three stats on a normal player's HUD other than VPIP, PFR, and 3-bet. They don't even know what they're talking about. They don't know what the HUDs look like. They have no idea what the interpretation of the data takes, what it means to do it, what it means to come up with comprehensive strategies that actually account for the stats that they're reading, okay? They also don't know what it's like for these people to play 100,000 hands a month of Zoom. It's a difficult fucking task, and there's tons of people who do it, and it's you know, look, they're not curing cancer, but this is the career choice that they picked, and I think they're doing a good job at it, and they should be commended for that. You shouldn't just say, fuck you, you're bad for poker because I like to play, you know, my home games with friends and I can't win on stars. You know, they're better than you. That's why, because they work harder and because they've figured out a way to win. Now, I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with losing at poker or just playing poker for fun. Okay, I think it's great. I mean, all of us pros, we were all amateurs at one point. We all started playing for fun. I have no malice or animosity to amateurs who are playing. I don't want to make it sound like that. I very much like want anyone who likes poker to play poker. And if it's your goal to have fun, then that's great. And I think that's a fine way to spend your time having fun if that's what you like to do. Okay, but I hate the way people talk about the mass multi-tablers. They just dismiss them like all they've done is they've written a script on how to play poker. It's just total nonsense. It's just not the case at all. And anyone who says it clearly has just, you see what they're, the content of what they're saying. It's clear that they are very ignorant about the subject. Okay. So what do I think they should do? It was the second part of your question. I don't know. I have no idea. If they take away Elite and they lower bonuses for Supernova, and you know, that means that you're, you know, somebody at 50 cent a dollar no limit who's winning at like 5 big blinds per 100 before rake is now like a significant losing player probably. I don't know exactly what the rake is at 50 cent a dollar no limit, but in PLO they'd be losing for sure. So I don't know. It's you know, it's, while it's commendable to be winning at 3 or 4 big blinds per 100 before rake, in relatively tough games, now you're going to be a losing player with those numbers. So clearly, do something else. Or get better, or do something else would be my start. I mean, but also, people should fight and really like try to change Star's mind about this. Like, I've been getting a lot of most of the responses I've gotten on Twitter have been positive and been encouraging to me, but I also get some random donkeys who are just like, oh, what are you ever going to fucking accomplish with this? Stars will never listen to you. Like, this is my favorite is the, where people explain to me how capitalism works. And they're like, they're a business operating in their own personal interests. It's like, yeah, I know that. You think you're the first person that's realized that? It's like, first of all, we're trying to tell Stars why they're wrong, and it's not in their personal, not in their business interest. We're also trying to tell them that they have a code of ethics that they should adhere to. We're also trying to tell them that we as a body of players have influence over them. Look, they have no competition. So nobody's going to come and take away their customers by offering a better product right now. Okay, so the only leverage we have is us as a community of players to raise hell. And this isn't unprecedented, you know? Last year, they raised the rake. And what happened? People raised fucking hell. People went nuts. And guess what happened? They lowered the rake after. We can make a difference when we do these things. You know, when we as a community get outraged, it actually matters. And it's not just about being outraged and tweeting at PokerStars, fuck you, Amaya. Thanks, Amaya. You ruined everything. Fuck you, David Bezos. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about the unintelligent nonsense, foaming at the mouth hysteria. I'm talking about making like clear, substantive arguments why they're wrong, okay? Why what they're doing is going to hurt the games and what we can do about it. And I don't have a solution for what we can do about it, but I'm just trying to say that there is value to collaborating and being a more of a unit on this than we have in the past.
Yeah, I think your example of the rake being raised and being lowered. I actually do want to say that I have heard a couple of different things. One thing that I heard is that, it's allegedly, of course, is that the proposed changes to Supernova and Supernova Elite for next year might not actually be able to take place. They might actually have to honor the original, what they originally said. Now, I'm not 100% positive on that, but that's something that I've heard. I also heard, allegedly, that the initial proposed changes by the people at Amaya was for that to rake back to actually be lower than 30%. It was to be somewhere between 20 and 25%. But there were people who fought for that on the player side to get that back up to the point it is now. So I don't know yet. I mean, I think those are two fringe things, allegedly, of course. Yeah. But
well, that you bring up a point that I think is important for people to acknowledge and think about when they're discussing the inner workings of Amaya and PokerStars and the decision making. People need to remember this is a huge company with many employees, and I don't know the exact internal workings, but I'm sure that there are moments where there is a conflict of power of different departments, you know, things like that going on. You know, PokerStars is not one monolith entity. It's there's many components to it. And I think, you know, when you make a convincing argument about this and you present it in a intelligent and well thought out way, people at PokerStars are going to read it. Okay. They're going to read it. They read the threads, you know, and it actually will have an impact on some people. And I'm not saying I'm going to write a post and PokerStars is going to change their mind, but maybe I write a post and some employee in PokerStars is like, yeah, he brings up a good point. And then he brings it up in a meeting. Like this is how the information is passed over, you know? So yeah, I mean, yeah, I think I addressed that.
And I think that I brought that up because I think it tied into your point in that people as a community, as players, can have an impact on things. Obviously, if they're looking at this from a business sense, and we can very much assume some of the people at Amaya don't have much experience in the poker community, understand how poker really works, the poker community works at all. So if you are presenting a legitimate argument, I mean, I'm sure they're all reading the threads. I'm sure they're probably watching this. I'm sure they're very active. They know what people are saying about this. So if you have a case to present, I would present it. And I think we're seeing that I think we're going to see a lot of top players out there. I know, who have you read that I've seen? I know Phil Gaffan just started posting a couple of different things. I know Mike Brooks, he posted a couple of really good arguments in the threads. I mean, this is brand new news. And I'm not really sure, like, who are the leaders exactly in the poker community right now that can fight for the player side in this, do you think?
I mean, I don't know. The thing is, a lot of the most well-known names in poker are not the people who are most affected by this, right? Like, the
right, super exactly.
Leaders are not necessarily the visible people. They're not the ones that are on TV that most people know about. But they are customers, and they are very high rake-paying customers who PokerStars has in the past shown a strong desire to cater to and listen to. I wouldn't just like completely disregard that anyone at the company still feels that way. I mean, I would assume some do. And you know, it's not just about who you are; it's about what you say. And so we can hope that, you know, more people will be vocal about this, because I think it's fucked up, you know? And like I said earlier, I want to make it clear, like, I didn't complain about the rake changes last year. I mean, I was pissed about them, and I was glad that players gathered together and did protests and things like that. I think that's an effective means of arguing with stars here. But, you know, and I thought they were a mistake from a business perspective. I thought it was going to backfire. I thought it was clearly wrong decision. But it's not like they weren't breaching any trust by doing it. Okay, they were changing their price. So that's one of the things that a bunch of the people the few people who have disagreed with me on Twitter or on TwoPlusTwo, they're like, they're a company. They can do whatever they want. Yeah, I understand that, and that's why I didn't freak out last time. Because that's all they were doing. They were just changing their price. But this is completely different. This is a very different act that they've done by not honoring the Supernova Elite rewards. And it shows their clear intent, what they're trying to do. Or maybe intent's not the right word, because like I just said, PokerStars is not some singular entity. It's made up of tons of different employees and executives and shareholders and different interests. So maybe it's not malice by them. Maybe it's just sheer incompetence. I'm not sure.
So ultimately, what good do you think this does for anyone? Is the only good it does make more money from Amaya?
The thing is, I don't even think it's going to make them more money. Like, if their plan is they need to shake up the way the poker economy works right now, they need to shake it up. They don't want to keep incentivizing mass volume players. They think that's the best solution. I'm not even sure if that's true, but whatever. They have the market research. They have their.
Didn't they say that in the press release? They said that they don't want to incentivize people to just play for rewards. They want to have you steal your nerve and compete or something. Something of that nature. Yeah, yeah. Was the wording.
Who came up with that nonsense? Anyway, so yes, they said that. That's the tone. Now, that's totally within reason for them to say that and to do that. I'm not saying that it's wrong for them to change their position on that. That's obviously fine. But first of all, it's about agreements that we have. Secondly, this isn't a shift. This is a full 180 turnaround, okay? And it's like overnight. It's a massive, massive shift, and it's super fast. And I don't think they've given players, you know, they haven't given players the appropriate explanation or communication that we deserve. And in advance, I'm going to respond to all the people who say, PokerStars doesn't owe you a living. PokerStars doesn't owe you
shit.
Whatever. It's like, fine. I don't owe them anything either, but we're if that's your position, if you're going to say that there is no personal connection whatsoever between PokerStars and its customers, none, that it doesn't exist, that everything in life, you know, I don't know, somebody who's read too many Ayn Rand books, everything in life is just pure utilitarian, everybody just acts in their own self-interest, and there's no such thing as agreements or customer service or any kind of loyalty or anything. Fine, that doesn't, none of that exists, makes no difference for our reaction, because then we're also acting in our self-interest and raising hell so that they actually understand that there might be consequences to when they roll over us like this, that there actually might be, we might be able to affect their bottom line, okay? That's our self-interest response to their purely self-interest action, okay? And, you know, fine. Well, if that's your approach, fine. Even though I don't agree with it, but it either way, it doesn't even matter how you look at it. There's just no argument for players to take this lying down. None.
Yeah, I think another thing they said was interesting was that this will only affect 2% of the players.
That's another one of the things. Yeah, this is one of the reasons it's so tilting. It's just so dishonest, and it's so ridiculous. They said, oh, it'll only affect 2%. This is for the 98% of PokerStars players. What percentage of those accounts are dormant and somebody deposited $25 when they were in college 8 years ago and doesn't play anymore? Are you counting those? What about the guy who literally plays the 10-cent tournaments a few days a week? Are you counting him as a value player? Okay. Or to present it as if the 2% are just like the rich guys. It's ridiculous. I don't know. I was raising that on Twitter. I don't know if they're trying to invoke some sort of like the Occupy Wall Street movement where they're like, we are the, you know, we're representing the 99%, not the 1%, as if PokerStars is something other than the 1%. And they're like trying to appeal to that trend to make recreational players who are losing, make them feel like they're being, you know, they're being supported. Their PokerStars has got their back. It's total nonsense. PokerStars is just destroying you too by this. It's just total nonsense.
I just want to let people know that convert your FPPs sooner than later, because the conversion rate after the new year goes down from, I believe,
it goes from 1.6 cents per FPP to 1.2.
Correct. So and that's going to take place. So if you happen to have some FEPs on there, convert them now. Obviously, I think you're going to read that, but that is, you know, that's an interesting change. They're sort of just, if you don't convert your FEPs, are they going to automatically like turn them, the FEPs you have into 1.6 before that, and then you start over? Or is it just they're going to convert the FEPs into star coins?
They're converting them into star coins.
Hmm.
So FPPs will no longer exist. They're going to be called star coins.
Great. So if someone right now doesn't play for the next 2 months or be able to go on their PokerStars account, they're automatically just going to get, they got no choice. They just automatically take the worst conversion rate, it sounds like.
Say that again?
So if someone can't access their account before the first of the year, they're not going to be able to convert their stuff. So they're going to lose money.
Right. They get screwed. Also, anyone who let's say, was Supernova earlier in the year and lost it. You know, there's a lot, I know a lot of American pros who don't really play much online. They play like, you know, just during Scoop and WCoop and maybe one other weekend or something. So they'll lose their status after not playing for a few months or something like that. That happens all the time. So those guys, they might be some lower tier status now, and they might have millions of FPPs saved up. I mean, I know people who literally have millions of FPPs saved up. I'm not just making that up. That exists. And then they can't cash them in at the correct rate unless they go and grind and get to Supernova until the end of the year. It's totally ridiculous. They give them two months to decide.
So just so people that understand what Dani just said. So what that means is that there are players who would come back next spring and they would play a lot of tournaments, play a lot of cash games, they'd get Supernova status. Once they got Supernova status, they would then convert their FPPs over to cash bonuses because they're going to get a better rate than a Bronze Star would. Now, that person, if they're in the United States or if they're in a different country, in a Portugal or Spain, I mean, if they're anywhere that you can't play on the .com, now it's sort of could be impossible potentially for some people now to go back outside the country, then grind up Supernova, convert those. And if they have millions of FPPs saved up, like I'm sure there's some players out there, they're going to take a pretty big loss on their points. I think that was
the, right. There's no, you know, I mean, this was something I read in my original post. For those who didn't read it, PokerStars, you know, because they're a publicly traded company now, and because they're owned by Amaya and Amaya is publicly traded, they have to release all of their financial information. And I read through one of their financial reports because I was just curious to look up some things. And in it, they discuss their frequent player point liability. Basically, the balance of frequent player points in all accounts that they're holding, that on their balance sheet is counted as debt, basically. It's counted as liability, money that they owe, but not with like a payment plan or anything, because obviously they only have to pay it out when players request the cash out. So PokerStars has $100 million in FPP liability. It's like $105 million, okay? So pushing through a measure that will devalue FPPs, I'm not sure that, I mean, it's a 25% devaluing, but it could also end up being less if you weren't Supernova or something. I'm not sure exactly. I'm not going to speculate on the exact impact that this will have on their FPP liability, on how much it'll go down, but it will go down after this. And maybe that's why they're doing it, is because they thought that number was too big and they wanted it to be smaller. Because it says in the section where they explain what the FPP liability is, that like PokerStars has to set aside this money as like operating. They can't basically, they can't operate with like a negative balance of the liability. Like, basically they have to reserve funds to be able to pay people out this liability, right? Mm-hmm. Like they have to make sure they have the 100 million on hand in order to pay people out.
A lot of people are asking about, do you think about players should maybe think about going on a new site? Options out there, 888 poker, iPoker, Party Poker. None of those really inspire much, a lot of hope. I mean, there's a Unibet for Euro players. I think Unibet's doing some things that would be an option. Pretty sure a little bit different version of poker than PokerStars. So what do you see? Do you think people should go play on a different site? I mean, I think they should go try out different sites at least. If your rakeback is going to be the same or potentially more on other sites, I think it's definitely worth your time to go check out the action, check out the games on these other sites.
Yeah, I mean, I think you should definitely look at what options are available. I don't know, you know, it depends on what games you play and what sort of liquidity there is on those other sites for the games you play. I mean, if you play mixed games, you don't really have a choice of where to play. If you play PLO, you know, there's a couple options at up to high stakes, but you know, not a ton. Yeah, I mean, I would definitely try playing on other sites and see what it's like, see how you like experience. But the thing is also like these other sites suck too. You know,
they're not their customer service isn't.
This is the problem, is that PokerStars is supposed to be the site where you can just play there because it's that good, but they're really ruining that. You know, they're really trying hard to push people to these disaster of companies like Party Poker. And I really wish one of the other sites would step up and try to do something right now aggressive to try to get customers from PokerStars, but it doesn't seem like any of them have anything in the works.
I just want to remind people that Amaya, I don't know if they still own OnGame, but they've owned OnGame, and OnGame has gone from an okay option a couple years ago to literally one of the worst fucking sites that exist. I mean, one of my OnGame skins stole my money. So like,
I think I lost like 3,000 euros on one of those OnGame skins.
Right. Exactly. This is the site that they own, or they owned. Yeah. I mean, if Stars takes the same trajectory that OnGame took, which it seems like it actually is, you know, I'm not sure. I guess the other option, obviously, you can play live poker. You can check out the other sites. You can see how things work out with Stars. I mean,
yeah. I mean, look,
obviously,
I don't...
it is, if it is what it is, if the changes go through, well, you got to figure, you can either complain or you can, you know, you can start figuring out. You also, at the same time, you want to figure out a strategy to be successful for yourself if you're going to keep playing poker. And I mean, from your perspective, obviously you're losing out on how much, 40, 50K in potential rake back next year. If you got Supernova Elite, even more.
Anywhere from like 50 to 70,000 ish, maybe more than 100 if I would have gotten Elite, but I won't get Elite though. So
how does that affect your approach to poker coming up here in 2016 then?
I mean, I guess it's kind of like a wait and see thing. I'll see what's going on in the games. I'm kind of afraid that the games are going to be really bad now for a while. I mean, there's just no way to tell right now what's going to happen. You know, a lot of people, because I've been so vocal, are like looking to me for solutions, and I don't have a solution. You know, I'm saying what's wrong and why Stars is wrong and why you should be pissed. I haven't, you know, I don't know where to go from here yet necessarily. Or certainly haven't thought about it too much yet. Like other people have asked me that, right? Like, so what are you gonna do next year? Just, I don't know.
Yeah.
It depends on who's playing 2550 next year. Yeah, I mean, I always play a lot of live poker during the year. It's always roughly like 25% of my yearly play. I'm gonna go to Vegas again and play the whole series and play cash games, and maybe I'll play some more live trips that I wouldn't normally. I don't know. But yeah, it's pretty, the blatant attack on high stakes players is is really disappointing. And again, now this is something that I didn't go too hard at on Twitter or in my TwoPlusTwo post. I didn't really address the high stakes thing that much because I don't want it to seem like my anger here is only self-serving, because that's the part that mostly affects me. Because really most of my anger is not even directed at it. It's at everything else. Mm. But I do think that taking all rake back away from high stakes is a tremendous slap in the face to all their high stakes players, many of whom are some of their best customers and highest rake paying players. It's basically saying our business is not wanted. You are not wanted here. We will continue to serve you because we wish you weren't here. And it's crazy because it's like everybody else getting VIPs except for high stakes cash-in players. It's like a specific exclusion from the VIP program, because they're not abolishing completely. They're still going to have Supernova and 30% rewards and stuff, but they're like, everyone except you. You guys, you suck. You're gross. You're not part of this anymore. That's what they're saying. And it's really a slap in the face. And I think it's just like really shocking from a company that clearly uses its high stakes players in many aspects to promote the game. They love talking about people having huge wins. I'm sure they love the fact that Isildur is on there on the grind all the time playing 200, 400, and poker fans are all over the world watching in amazement as he plays. I think there used to be a very obvious, obviously with Full Tilt back in the day, they very much believed in the high stakes Railbird model of marketing that encouraged people to play high stakes. It's kind of its own economy, and then it will really encourage other players to play more poker and to be inspired by them. It seems like it was hugely successful for Full Tilt for a while. And I think PokerStars is essentially, they're basically saying, screw the dream. There is no dream anymore. You cannot start at the bottom and win your way up to the top playing poker. That was really what started the poker boom, though. It was, Moneymaker was like, if he was the star of it, it was, look, you can be some Joe Schmo and you can defeat poker. You can be the champion, right? And then people that got a little more into it, they saw what was going on online. They watched the super high stakes games. It was inspirational to them. It was inspirational to me. That's why I started playing poker. I mean, that's why I started moving up in stakes. I would watch higher stakes games. When I say it's why I moved up in stakes, it's not necessarily that me playing higher stakes is better for them, but me working hard to get to higher stakes and playing higher volume is good for them. And that includes recreational players who they still want to get better. They still want to play higher stakes if they can. And so what they're basically doing is they're just shitting on the dream. They're saying that there is no dream anymore. Would I have ever gotten into poker when I was 18 years old and like living in a college dorm room if there was a clear-cut message that this is a dead end? It goes nowhere. You will not win at 1-2. You will not win at 2-4. Don't even bother going to high stakes. It's not even there anymore. And that's the message that they're sending, whether they believe it or not. That is the message that they're sending, and that is the message that will be received by the poker community and by poker players and by potential poker players. Okay. If you think about all the new marketing that they're doing and the way they're shifting towards Twitch and basically marketing poker as more of like a video game sort of,
That's true.
Not necessarily like the televised sport, but it's more of like an e-sport now, and I know that that's going to continue to be a big shift in their marketing and I know that they've gotten a lot of signups from Twitch. So first of all, it seems obvious that a Twitch stream would be more popular if it was at higher stakes. These guys who play League of Legends for a living and can win, 100K a year or 50K a year or something if you're like the best in the world. Why would they be so interested in watching a 1-2 game where
the guy can make $40,000 a year if he's like the best in the world at it. Or maybe they'll see like someone playing 100, 200 and winning a 100K pot. What do you think will get more streamers? What do you think people will be more interested by, more intrigued by, more and one? And the whole point is that when you watch someone on Twitch, some random guy winning, you know, a $10,000 pot or a $50,000 pot or something, the thought goes to your head, I can do that. He's just a guy like me. I'm just, you know, the whole point is that it brings it to the everyman, right? That's what Twitch, that's the whole point of their Twitch marketing. But they're basically distancing themselves from that. And I think it's a huge mistake.
Faden on YouTube says, Ansky getting right to the heart of it right here. That's the whole fucking brand. It's called Pokerstars. And I think, you know, something you mentioned is exactly how I got started in poker personally back in the day. You'd see Full Tilt. You'd see the red pros on there. You see guys battling at high stakes. You see the high stakes games run on Pokerstars. Like, that was my only goal. That was the reason why I worked so hard, put in so many hours, put in so many hands, was because I wanted to play those high stakes one day. I wanted to get to that point. And that was my dream. That was literally my fucking dream. And like, maybe, I don't know, maybe there's new poker dreams. Maybe the poker dreams to play a spin and go and win the million. I don't know. Maybe they want the dream to be something else. Maybe that, and I think the poker dream never really dies. There's always other ways to make, you know, whatever, if you say 100K is what you want to make. There's a lot of ways to make 100K playing poker, whether it's live or online. Online, I mean, yeah, you got to play a little higher stakes, but live, possible. But it seems like now their PokerStars' dream of poker is spin and goes. Basically spin and goes. It seems like that's really what their main focus is now, is spin and goes.
Yeah, I haven't kept up too much on the spin and go thing. Like, I remember when they first came out, everyone was outraged. And I actually made a post that basically said, like, I think this is fine. It's good for the game. And I got a lot of shit for it. But my main point was, PokerStars is allowed to offer new games, right? You know, if the issue is the rake in them, then that's definitely worth bringing up and worth criticizing. But I think it's fine to offer new games, especially if they're popular ones, because it brings people onto the site. Somebody's not going to join PokerStars, play a spin and go, and then literally never venture out into the regular poker world. Or maybe they will. I can't say that for sure. But I would assume that just getting him on the site is worth a lot of value to the poker community as a whole and to poker economy, you know? So, you know, I'm not going to say that that they shouldn't be going down the spin and go road necessarily, or that's like not the, I don't think that that's like, there's anything wrong with that inherently, because like I said earlier, I'm trying to make this as much of like a substantive argument about why it's beneficial for all parties involved and why what they're doing is wrong. I can't say that marketing spin and goes is wrong. I don't think it does start to shift away from what we as poker players appreciate about poker, and that it's a beatable game. I think that is very scary that they're moving away from that. You know, for years, you know, in terms of like lobbying government and regulators, the argument has always been, this is poker. It's different. It's not blackjack. It's not roulette. You can win at it, you know? And it's why there's places that poker is legal and other games aren't, right? And it's like, part of it is our entire message or defense as poker players is like, this is not a game of just, I mean, obviously it's a gambling game. It's not a game of pure luck, of pure nonsense. You know, it's a beatable game. You need to have winners at the game. Okay. And the winner shouldn't be just guys who won spin and goes. They should be people who are winning players. Okay. That is an integral part of what poker is. And it's an integral part of what makes poker different and what makes it acceptable for society, and why it should be acceptable in situations where roulette isn't, you know.
Bluff Spice brings up a point actually that I want to talk about too. I've thought about the conspiracy theorist in me wonders how much of the HUD restriction is just to protect themselves, aka make it so people will not be able to data mine and find things like the mid-stakes PLO botch, which is obviously a very big situation. So for those who don't know, there was a botting situation in the PLO community where the biggest winners at 1-2 and 2-4 were confirmed to be bots. They're not playing on the site anymore. And the reason these bots were found out was through a data mining site, Russian PTR, and the work of the community found this out. There was nothing done on Star's part. There's really been no communication about the matter at all. And without HUD, without the Russian PTR, without the data mining sites, we never find these things out. And I mean, I'm sure this has to be a thought in their minds to think about, all right, well, if we get rid of this, we get rid of this. Well, none of these cheating scandals come up. Now, how are we supposed to know about the cheaters in the future, people that are bots, if we don't have that sort of thing, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's a fair point that data mining protects the players in addition to the Star security team. It's our own security team. But I just want to quickly address something that he said. And this is something that you see people saying all the time in this discussion. HUDs have nothing to do with data mining. HUDs have nothing to do with, or the existence of HUDs have nothing to do with data mining. The use of HUDs has nothing to do with a data mining site or with your own ability to track stats, okay? A HUD is just a heads-up display, okay? The bots were discovered through comparing stats from a database, okay? The HUD is just what you see while you are playing, okay? And if you take away the ability, to have a heads-up display, you can still look at stats in your poker tracker. The only way that they're gonna get rid of that, they're gonna completely get rid of the ability to observe stats of your own play and your opponents, is if they completely remove hand histories, I think would be the only solution. But even then, that doesn't actually do it, because I know there's been sites in the past that don't have hand histories that you can still, you were able to track hands using some screens.
You're able to track hands, but you're not able to get those hands actually off into a program. That's when I was talking about that, I was thinking that they might just eliminate the entire way to import the hands into a hold'em manager. Therefore, you can't, as a player, look through your stats and see these guys are doing the same thing in this weird spot in this situation. You're not going to be able to do that anymore.
You think they would eliminate hand histories? Hand histories don't exist.
I don't think so. I mean, I don't know. I didn't think a lot of these things that are happening right now would happen.
Like, what I'm saying is, just removing a HUD doesn't prevent detection of bots, right? I mean, it certainly would make it a little bit more difficult if you can't compare two different players at the same time that look the same. But you can always look up player stats in Poker Tracker or on a second computer if you have. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is the problem. I don't want to talk too much about HUDs because...
Yeah, I don't think HUDs is the main issue here, really. But obviously, it's something that people are... some people seem happy about, the HUDs being removed. That seems to be a pretty decent sentiment out there.
The reason I don't want to talk about HUDs too much is because it conflates the two things as if they're the same issue. They're not the same issue. It's completely unrelated. As far as I can tell, the only reason they released this information at the same time was to confuse people and make people think that the two had something to do with each other. They have nothing to do with each other. They can remove HUDs. They can remove seeding scripts. They can also just leave the VIP system the same. They can remove the VIP system and leave HUDs and scripts. These two are not related. They're not related. The only thing I want to say quickly about HUDs, regarding what you said, lost my train of thought a little bit. Is the removal of HUDs, people say it just get rid of it, it's removing a button or something. The problem is, if you remove it in a haphazard way and you basically say stop using it and you prevent just Poker Tracker from running a HUD or something, what you're doing is you're going to get all the compliant players to remove it, but then you're going to create a situation where players are very incentivized to use a HUD on a second screen or to do something that's not detectable by Stars, and then that's a real unfair advantage that you're enabling players to have, okay? Because not everyone's going to follow the rules, and then you're basically knowingly creating a situation where a bunch of people are going to have an unfair advantage. Look, right now, HUDs are not an unfair advantage. They're just an advantage that some people have and some people don't because they choose not to have them, okay? But it's not unfair. It's there for anyone who wants it. If you take HUDs away and you don't do it effectively, you don't do it in a way that comprehensively removes them, okay, then you're creating a situation where there's gonna be a black market of HUDs, and those players will start having a much bigger advantage because they'll be able to actually use HUDs on tons of people who don't have them. Okay, that's my piece on HUDs. I don't want to go too much into that.
I mean, there's also the case that Stars could just be implementing their own HUD system. Maybe you pay a fee to use a Stars HUD. I mean, that would, if Amaya is trying to, I don't want to give him an idea, but if Amaya is trying to maximize their money. You know, why would they? Why would they let Hold'em Manager and Poker Tracker make all the money in this situation? So that could be their ideas. And
I saw a little bit about that online. I I mean, the thing is, I don't want to speculate on that because it's not real news yet. So when it's news, I'll comment. But it's not.
So I guess, what do you think could be changed? I mean, what if you had it? Like, is there a compromise in the situation? Do you think
Look, there's no compromise from the point where they started. Okay, a compromise is when two parties come together with reasonable starting points and reach a middle ground. Okay, a compromise is not I steal your wallet and then I offer you half of it back. Okay? That's not a compromise. That's just stealing less. Okay, the Supernova Elite theft where they for the whole year have listed the rewards and included the continuing value of making it by more than 1 year and then going back on that. That to me, that's like completely non-negotiable. I don't see how they could ever go back on that. Removing all VPPs from high stakes. Yes, I would negotiate that. I mean, I think they could keep the VPPs same and maybe just charge a little bit more rake. I can't believe I just even let those words out of my mouth, but that would be within the realm of conceivable solution. Basically, if they're saying that high stakes cost too much to run because of transaction costs or some nonsense like that, which I don't know what, because they didn't explain it because they're not communicating with us. So
hold on a second, Donnie. Let me make sure I get to pull up the press release here. I want to read this part to the people because I had to read it a bunch of different times. I wasn't sure I read it correctly. No VPPs for pot limit and no limit games with blinds of 5, 10 plus, 8 game, 10, 20, and other limit games. This change is implemented due to high transaction costs and operating cost of monitoring these games. So a high transaction cost and the operation cost of monitoring the games, therefore no VPPs. That's why.
Thing is, like, we don't know what that means, so it's hard for us to comment on it. Like, this is the thing. They can't expect us, like, they can't think that we're being, like, indignant and enraged without justification if they're not going to properly explain what they're doing. You know, we can't assume that everything they're doing is correct. You know, we're going to be enraged by this unless they explain why we shouldn't be. So if they're losing money on high stakes or their operating costs are too high to justify it and they think that they need to rake it higher, I don't think I wouldn't have like lost my mind about that if that was part of the, like, put it this way. Let's say they increased the rake at high stakes by double, and I'm not saying that you do this.
Oh,
I'm
just saying, okay.
I'm just
hypothetically,
they increased the rake by double when this initial announcement was made, but kept the VPP system the same for high stakes. I would never have even included it in my original post. I would never even have brought it up because it's not an unjustifiable change, and it's not a game wrecking change. It's not like it's not a destroyer. Okay. I mean, double is kind of a destroyer. I should have used a different multiplier, but, like, you know, 1.4x or something. So, but to completely, like, remove it, it's such a harsh message, I think, and I hate it. But
yeah, I wanna clarify another thing we were talking about earlier about, you know, Dane Negreanu making some comments on Twitter and people interacting with him, and I mean, I think I like Daniel a lot. I think he's in a very, he's very vocal, obviously. He's the one person. So it's interesting. You have the Stars representatives, and most of them you can't really access. Most of them you ask a question to or you talk to, they don't talk back. So Daniel is the one person that does talk back. Obviously, sometimes he might say some things that people might not agree with or might not even be correct. He's his own person. He's just commenting. He sees a comment, he comments about it. So I don't necessarily think we should really get upset at him. He is obviously saying some things we might not agree with or people out there might not agree with, but I think it's great to have somebody at least who is communicating with people. I mean, people are tweeting at him. He's talking back. No one else is doing that. Stars isn't doing that. and no other players are doing that. So I think from that standpoint, I mean, you gotta, people should give him some leniency, basically, because a lot of people are, I feel like they are getting pretty angry at him and maybe attacking him in a way that might be a little bit out of line.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, he's a paid employee, so he has to handle this differently than other people, and he's going to take his time to make any public response. That's fine, and he should. It's understood that he has to do that. But you know, he also has very much made the decision and thrust himself into the position of being an ambassador for the game, and part of that means he's representing the players, representing the people who don't have who don't have a PokerStars CEO on their in their phone number or in their phone book. I mean, he is our representative, whether we like it or not. He represents us in a lot of ways. He doesn't always represent us, but I mean, he we can speak to him and he can maybe pass the message on or maybe not. We don't know, but it's still a possible opportunity, you know? And it's, you know, it's just, and then things, the way he's presented himself in media and, you know, the fact that he makes the millions of dollars that he does as a Stars pro, as like their main pro, he's the face of their company basically. Him doing that, entitles players to think that they have a little bit that he owes them something. He owes them a little bit of a explanation, or he's always committed to saying that he will. I mean, he's always basically been open about talking about these things. You know, mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's commendable, but I do think it's fine for players to have high expectations of him and to be upset if they think they aren't being met. But like I said, the important thing is to just wait and chill a little bit, because he does have to approach this differently than you or I.
We'll take a couple questions out there for people if you guys have any good questions. What do you think is the best case scenario? Let's say everything stays in place. What's been said and happens and nothing other crazy. I mean, you never, who knows what's going to happen. What do you think best case scenario is out of this?
I don't know. I mean, I think getting the Supernova Elite rewards restored would be a small win. I think, I think any reduction of what they said would at least show that it's good to get mad about this. It's not good to just say, oh, well, you know, they're a capitalist entity acting in their own self-interest. I took an economics class in college, so I'm an expert on this. I think we should let them be. No, I don't think that's the approach. No. I think getting pissed off and fighting for ourselves is a good solution. I mean, it's not a solution. It's a good starting point.
We actually got Daniel in the chat. He says, "You are safe, bud. I'm on calls all day working on this shit." So.
Huh? Oh, Negrano said
that? Yeah, in the chat right now, in the YouTube chat, yeah. Yeah. So we'll see what happens. I mean, we'll see what comes from it. Let me see some questions here. Will YOLO says, no, not that one. No, not that one. Are the high stakes going to be profitable for the top regs? 100% yes, but...
Yeah, I mean, regs that are winning in 10 big blinds per 100 are not gonna start losing because of the rake. It's not a fair comparison though, because it's not like it's just a reduction in big blinds per 100. The issue is now the games won't run, or there'll be less liquidity at high stakes, less incentive to start games, less incentive for weaker regs to take shots, just lower stakes regs who are trying to get better and might want to move up to 25-50 if they think they can beat it. Less incentive for them to move up. The biggest jump, obviously, now is like the enormous jump is really going to be 2.5 to 5.10 because
no rake back.
Yeah, doubling the stakes and cutting out all the rake back. That's going to be a big barrier. It's going to be really tough to see. Like I said, the dream is dead. It's going to be really tough to see people moving up in stakes.
Yeah, I feel like from what I've been hearing, I think they're really going to remove some sort of table selection process. And I think if that happens, we won't see any action at 5-10 at all. It doesn't make sense. This is from PLO. So I think people are going to play 3-6 with rakeback rather than play 5-10. If the 5-10 players, unless there's some sort of like master pool where there's a, I honestly can't even imagine what they're going to come up with. But you're going to see if a fun player's in the game, the regs are going to come. If a fun player's not there, the game's literally never going to run. They'll play 3-6. And I think ultimately that's what their goal is out of this. They want people to be playing lower stakes.
Yeah, I mean, that's certainly the model that all the other sites have. They don't want people playing high stakes. You know, I mean, I don't have anything to say about that. I think it's bad. Mm-hmm. People will doubt my opinion in this somewhat because it has the most direct effect on me. But I think I've presented a pretty good case why it's bad. And it's not just based on my own self-interest. I feel like poker still has marketability as a game which you can win at. And it's exciting to see the best players winning or losing at it. It's exciting to watch the huge amounts of money changing hands. I don't know. I mean, like, there's entire, like, you know, there's the high stakes thread on 2+2. There's high stakes DB. There's like entire, I mean, the high stakes DB is an entire business based around railbirding, right? I mean, obviously they're probably, I assume they're like an affiliate or something like that. And that's where they make their actual money from. But, you know, there's a huge amount of fandom in poker. I mean, people watch the World Series of Poker on TV because it's high stakes, because the money being exchanged hands is enormous. Okay. People don't watch, they don't have televised 1-2 no limit cash games, you know? So clearly there's something to be said for poker, high stakes poker as a marketing tool. You know, I'm trying to focus on things that I know a lot about, that I think I know a lot about, at least. You know, I'm not an expert in marketing. I don't know what data they have on this sort of thing, but it seems like they went from being a company that had an enormous amount of insight and appreciation, and they seemed really sharp about what was going on in the poker world. They seem really disconnected now. They seem like they used to be a site that had lots of poker players involved and understood what were the needs and wants of poker players. Now they don't seem to have any idea what's going on. It's turning into party poker. PokerStars is turning into party poker. That's what everyone should be afraid of.
Yeah, I think you need to fight in situations like this. You need to make your case because it's only going to get worse. It's not like it's going to get better. Once this happens, this goes through, well, then there's going to be new changes. There's going to be new fees. There's going to be... like, it's not just going to stop at this. Like, all right, we fucked them enough. Let's give them a break. No, it's going to keep getting worse and worse. So if there's anything that people can do to make a case for something, then delay. I guess we're delaying the inevitable action that happens here in the future. So Daniel did say, he said, give me a few days to figure this all out. I'll post a blog, and I can only promise you that I won't breach my integrity one bit. I'm officially stressed about it and have some really big decisions to make, so... I guess we shall see what happens on that front. Don, you have anything else you want to add? Do we cover most of the things?
No, I think I said my piece. If there's no more questions, I think that's just about it. I hope people appreciate that this is a big deal. It's a really big deal. Even people who don't play at PokerStars, I think they should think this is a big deal. You know, PokerStars, whether you're a part of it or not, represents like 70% of online poker traffic, which means they represent a huge, huge majority of just poker as an entity in the world. You know, they are the leader in poker. Mm-hmm. Okay, so even if you don't play on PokerStars, this is very concerning. It should be still very concerning to you because the future of poker and the future of how it gets marketed, how it gets branded, how it gets raked, how other, you know, because other sites and casinos and things like that will, you know, they they look to the PokerStars model. And they are so big, you know, they have so much gravity that everything around the everything related to poker is influenced by PokerStars. And so even players who don't play on Stars very much or don't play at all, I think should still follow this very closely. It's very important to your future as a poker player or as a poker amateur who likes poker, even that.
Well, guys, if you want to keep following along with this, you can follow me on Twitter, @JoeyNumber1. Follow Ansky on Twitter, @TheRealAnsky. There are some 2+2 threads. I think I put them in the description on the YouTube video that you'll be able to follow along with. Any comments on there? I'll be talking about this in an upcoming podcast. I'll probably do one with Jason Moe. I'm sure we'll who knows what I'll have to say about it. I'm sure some fun things. I might be podcasting tomorrow night with Brian Rast around this time as well. I don't think he's too tuned in with the online scene right now, but I'm sure we'll be able to talk to him about this as well. And I guess podcast Wednesday with Kate Hall. Having Kate Hall back on. She's one of Daniel's best friends on Twitter. And if you follow Kate Hall on Twitter, she's very, we've had her on already, and she's very passionate about everything. So I just want to have her back on. And Friday, 4 p.m. Eastern will be Wednesday and Friday. Friday will be with this girl, Kristen Wilson, who started this poker company called Poker Refugees, which helped relocate about 500 poker players after Black Friday and all over the world. So I met her in Vegas. I really enjoyed her a lot and definitely want to have her on the podcast and get her company out there and get her story out there, because I thought it was pretty cool. So Donnie, thanks for coming on, buddy. I really appreciate the emergency podcast appearance by you, and we'll see what happens.
Emergencies call for emergency measures.
I know, I messaged you up. I was like, we need emergency pod. I mean, we just had you on. So I was like, I don't want to be on an emergency podcast. No, you wore the glasses and you wore the shirt today. So
yeah, this is serious business. There's no tank tops allowed.
Yeah. I didn't wear a tank top either today. So guys in the chat, YouTube, Twitch, had a lot of viewers today. Thank you very much. And we'll see what happens. Enjoy. Much love. Peace out. Adios. Colomosa, caramosita. See you, Danny.